Let us praise the Lord, saints. Let us praise the Lord another time. Hallelujah. Amen. We give all the glory to Jesus because of his tender mercies towards us. One more time, we are able to come into the presence of the Lord to lift up his holy name. And as we come together to join in worship, let us open our hearts to receive the blessings that the Lord have in store for us. And so this morning, let me give all the glory to God and thanking him for bringing us into the sanctuary. Let me greet all our ministers that are here, our elders, officers, and the beloved saints of the living God in the precious and mighty name of Jesus. There is just none like him. Hallelujah. There is just none to be compared to him. He's always keeping us, providing for us. Hallelujah. And so we just want to worship his holy name. Please stand and let's just bow our heads in prayer. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you. We thank you, God, that you're always with us. You've gone before us and you've made the way for us to walk in victory over all that comes against us. And I pray this morning, Father, as we gather together to worship you, Lord, we will do it from our whole heart and we'll bless the Most High. Oh God, that we in turn may receive a blessing from you. Keep us in your care continually. Sanctify us for your will and your purpose. Bless the service today. God, the leader, the moderator, we pray, Lord God, that you guide their hearts. And as we worship you, as we lift up your name, we pray that you'll pour us out a blessing as we give you thanks right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. At this moment, I have great pleasure to hand over to Sister Bronte Kerr, who will be leading this part of the service in Jesus' name. Amen.
Shall we praise the Lord, everyone? Let's praise the Lord, everyone. It's an honor and privilege to be in God's house one more time. Today is youth service. I pray that you'll be blessed. I pray that you'll get up and worship God with us in Jesus' name. I'm going to call on the praise and worship team to minister to us in Jesus' name.
Exalted, the Lord is exalted on high. I will praise him. He is exalted, the Lord is exalted, and I will praise him. Say,
he is exalted, the Lord is exalted on high.
And I will praise,
him.
He is
exalted.
Exalted on high. Sing with me now.
He is exalted. The Lord is
exalted on high.
He is exalted.
Said, I will praise,
yeah. He is exalted,
matchless God.
The Lord is exalted, and
I will lift up your name.
I will praise his name.
For he is Lord.
He is the Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let's continue to give God some praise. Hallelujah, hallelujah. For he is worthy, Lord God, you are worthy. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can everybody clap along with us? We're going to continue to give God some praise. I've said this once, I'm going to say it again. Let's just lift up his name. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Overcome, yes, he is overcome. We will not be shaken, we will not be moved. Jesus, you are here.
Carrying our burdens, covering our shame. He is overcome, yes, he is overcome. We will not be shaken, we will not be moved. Jesus, you are here.
I will live.
shout it out, shout it out.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah,
hallelujah.
You are worthy, God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. We thank you, Lord.
Come on, church. We worship the true and living King. Come on, church. Give him glory. Give him honor. Give him praise. Hallelujah. Bless his name. Bless his name. Hallelujah. At this moment in time, we're going to have a word of encouragement by Brother Shempinak.
Praise the Lord, everybody. I am glad to be here with you for your Sunday virtual service. I know this is not quite the way we would like to go. We're still getting used to this, but nonetheless, God has kept us in his mercy and allowed us to see another Sunday morning. And despite all odds, the saints have found a way together. I would like to greet Pastor O'Neill Lewis and his wife, Lady Maureen Lewis. Also, shout out to the Warsaw Lighthouse Youth Department and my good friend, Sister Alicia Kerr, for extending this invitation and opportunity for me to share with you what God has laid on my spirit. The scripture I'll be speaking from is the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 to 19, and I'll be reading from the New King James Version, and it reads as follows. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, "Some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he said unto them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, Son of the living God." Jesus answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatsoever you loose on earth will be loosed in the heavens." God gave this topic to me, and I want to share it with you. It's called His Presence, My Purpose. His Presence, My Purpose. I want to breathe a quick word of prayer, and then we'll jump straight into the word. Jesus, I thank you for this word. I thank you for your word. I thank you for your word. I thank you that it was made flesh. I thank you that it is tangible. I thank you that it still speaks. Lord God, I pray, Lord God, that your revelation will begin to unfold to your people. I pray, Lord God, that you will use me as a offering, Lord God. Pour into me as I pour out into your people, God. I pray somebody will be edified. Somebody will be transformed. I pray, Lord God, that this word will be a solution to somebody's problem and the answer to somebody's question. In Jesus' name. Amen. Now, this is a very familiar text. We've heard it preached a lot. We've heard it taught a lot. But I just really want to quickly put the text in context so that we get somewhat of a holistic understanding of what is taking place here. Now, Jesus had just finished dealing with the unbelief of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Now, all my life I've grown up in church. I've heard those terms and those names thrown around. And it wasn't until the other day I actually decided to do my research and find out what is a Sadducee. I have somewhat of an understanding of what a Pharisee is, but not very clear on what the Sadducees were. And upon my research, I did my Googling, and upon my research, I found out that the Sadducees were a group of scholars in the synagogue. They were a group of scholars and priests who only believed in the Torah. They only read and followed the Torah, which is the first five books of the Old Testament, that being Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. So they only really followed the Torah. Now, bearing in mind that there were a large majority and portion of those five books, three out of the five deal with the law, so they were heavily educated and aware of the law. However, what I found out upon my research was that they didn't really believe in the miraculous. They were a bit skeptical about the miraculous and the supernatural. So Jesus had just finished dealing with the unbelief of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. You see, they came to him seeking a sign and seeking to test him. Now, this confused me because, first of all, the Sadducees, like I said, they only followed the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament. And one of those books is Exodus. Now, Exodus is full, it is overflowing with the miraculous, it is overflowing with the supernatural. They read about, so these scholars, remember, they learnt and they were taught and they were educated and they knew it inside out. They read about Moses, they read about the 10 plagues, they read about the passing through the Red Sea and the waters going hither and thither. They read about the cloud by day and the fiery pillar by night. They were very aware that the miraculous existed. They were very aware that God performs miracles. However, they did not believe that God was currently performing miracles, that God was still working. And I was confused about this, and then it wasn't until I thought about it and God said to me, Hashem, this is no much different to the church today. We read the book, we understand it, we follow it, we say amen when the preacher's preaching, we quote the scriptures, but then do we really believe that God still works? Do we really believe that God still performs miracles? Do we really believe that he can make a way out of nowhere? And I know it's an unpopular thing to teach now. We have seen this new wave, I believe, of realism coming to the church, whereby we're not being so much spiritual but more practical. Now, I believe in being practical. I believe in taking practical measures. And, you know, the scripture says, you know, you can't be too heavenly minded that you're not of any earthly good. However, I still believe God. I still believe he can perform miracles. I still believe he's healing. I still believe he's making ways. I still believe he's delivering. I still believe in the resurrection power of Jesus Christ. I dare to believe. I know it's not popular. I know that given the circumstances of last year and this pandemic, we've seen loved ones die. We've seen men and women go on to glory. And it seems like, is God really still with us? Well, I have news to share. God is still with us and he's still performing. But here we see the Pharisees and the Sadducees have come to seek a miracle and a sign from Jesus. Now, wait a minute. Bear in mind, you have to remember, the Sadducees do not really believe in the miraculous. And watch this. They have no intention on believing in the miraculous. So no matter what Jesus does, they already have made up in their mind, their subconscious, to say, we will not believe, no matter what you do, no matter what you show us, no matter what sign you show us, we refuse to believe. This is a stubborn mentality, it's a stubborn spirit, it's a stubborn situation here. So I realize now this was a test to set him up, because you see, we're in chapter 16, but in chapter 12 we read about Jesus casting out the spirit, the unclean spirit that caused the man to be dumb, that caused the man to be unable to speak. After he finishes casting out this unclean spirit, once again here comes the Pharisees and the Sadducees, always in somebody's business, always being a busybody, getting on my nerves. But nonetheless, here we see they are once again, and they say, you have cast out this unclean spirit through the powers of Beelzebub, through the powers of Satan. Jesus looks at them and says, wait a minute, why would Satan cast out an unclean spirit? The unclean spirits work for Satan. And he says then to them, you know, a house divided against a house shall not stand. And he says, listen, Satan's kingdom is unified. Satan's kingdom is organized. Satan is going to fight. You don't ever see from Genesis to Revelation a devil fighting a devil. You don't ever see from Genesis to Revelation a witch fighting against a witch, an unclean spirit fighting against another unclean spirit. It only seems like in the church we have saints fighting against saints, but that's another subject for another day. Jesus here, now in chapter 16, realizes they're trying to set me up. If I perform a miracle, they're going to say I'm operating under the influence of satanic powers. If I don't perform a miracle, they're going to say, oh, see, he's not the son of God. He's not who he says I am. But here's the thing, and I want to teach you something, and I want to help somebody with this, especially us young people. You're going to find there are going to be people who are just not for you. No matter what you do, no matter how well you do it, they do not want to see you succeed. No matter how well you sing and you lead worship, they ain't gonna clap. They're gonna sit there with their face screwed and then they'll give you the side eye. No matter how well you preach and deliver the word of God with power and effect and articulate his word, they're not going to celebrate you. And you know what? That's okay. And the reason it's okay is because you're not doing it unto them. See, you will become disappointed, frustrated if all you're doing is trying to please people. That's not the aim and the object of ministry. The aim and the object of ministry is, number one, to please him. And then the Bible says, if I be lifted lifted up. He would do the drawing. But we're trying to do the drawing and not have any intention of lifting him up. We're trying to please man and not please God. But Jesus said, listen, I'm not trying to seek the validation of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. I don't need your validation. I don't need your approval. I've been certified and approved by God when I went into the Jordan and John the Baptist baptized me. The scripture says that the Father spoke from heaven and said, this is my Son in whom I am well pleased, and the Holy Ghost descended upon him. This was the ultimate validation anybody could receive. It was right there in that moment. Jesus was validated as the Son of God. Now Jesus said, listen, I'm not doing this to please you. You're not going to try and catch me out. I don't know what your plan is here, but it's not going to work. Somebody say it's not going to work. One of the things I found very interesting about Jesus is that whenever he performed a miracle, whenever he healed somebody, whenever he delivered somebody, whenever he set somebody free, he would say to the recipient of that miracle, don't tell anybody what just happened here. He will say to them, you know, I know you want to testify. I know you want to go all over the world and tell everybody what I just did, but I would greatly prefer if you didn't. You know, don't tell anybody what I just did. Don't tell anybody who I am. I know I just healed you, but don't tell anybody. And I was wondering, why did Jesus go to such great lengths to try and remain anonymous? Why did he not want his name to be renowned or his name to gain popularity or fame? And it's much different to our generation, because we're completely opposite. We want everybody to know what we're doing. We put it on social media, where we're going, when we're on vacation, what we're eating, what we're wearing. I try not to, because I personally like to live a more private life, and I don't want my name in these streets. But more importantly, I don't want my name in the pews, because I've learnt that the saints can be much more ruthless than those in the streets. But that's another conversation and message for another day. But nonetheless, Jesus is going to greatly left to try and remain anonymous. Despite his efforts, he is gaining popularity. Despite his efforts, he's aware that people are beginning to look at him. People are beginning to pay attention. He's drawing a crowd. He's aware that he is the latest gossip in the streets. And out of curiosity, he is with his disciples, his homeboys, his squad, his inner circle. And he says to them, he's just thinking, and he's wondering, well, I'm aware that, people are beginning to pay attention to me. So I'm just curious to see if they've figured it out yet. He says to the disciples, and who do men say that I am? And the disciples, said, well, the word on the street is your John the Baptist. The word on the street is your Elijah or Jeremiah or one of the prophets reincarnated. I find that very interesting that reincarnation was clearly a belief that then. But they read, they said, this is who people think you are. And he's like, okay, cool, nobody's figured out. Yeah, I'm safe, I'm still undercover, I'm still under low, nobody's clocked on yet. And then he says, wait a minute, out of curiosity, who do you say that I am? And the disciples pause and they're looking amongst themselves and they're thinking, to be honest, we don't know. Isn't that interesting? Isn't it interesting that these men walked with Jesus? These men had insight to his parables. When everybody else was just getting the parables, he would go away and explain the details and the insight and the meaning of these parables. These guys ate with Jesus. They walked with Jesus. They were familiar with him. They were his friends. They were the kind of friends who, you could come to your mother's house and just walk in and open the fridge and hug them. They were that kind of friends. Yet they were so close to him, and they had such a proximity with him, but they didn't know him. That blows my mind, and it speaks largely to us today, that we can come into church Sunday after Sunday. We can attend Sunday morning service, Sunday evening service, youth service, Bible study, Sunday school, and we walk into church with our Bible and our Pentecostal hymnal and say, I've been born and raised in the church, I've been saved all my life, I've been saved 60 years, 50 years, 40 years, whatnot. And the truth of the matter is, you can be all that and have no clue, my God, who Jesus is. That astounds me. That really does capture me, because I'm thinking, how do they not know? After all you've seen, oh my God, after all you've experienced, after all you've been through with him, after you've seen him pray, you've seen him walk on water, you've seen him cast out devils, you've seen him heal sick, you've seen him open blinded eyes, you've seen him do stuff that no man has ever done before in your sight, and still you have no idea who he is. And that is a very real reality that many of us have to come to and examine ourselves each individually and say, do I know him or do I know a form of godliness denying the power thereof? Do I know him or do I know something that resembles him? Do I know him or do I have the real, authentic relationship of who Christ is to me? And the disciples are looking at themselves and they're looking amongst themselves, and Simon Bar-Jonah stands up and breaks the silence and says, thou art the Christ, Son of the living God. Thou art the Christ. The word Christ is Christos, meaning thou art the anointed one, Son of the living God. And Jesus is astounded. Jesus takes a step back and he looks and thinks, oh my God. See, we read the scripture and it is familiar to us because it is not revelation to us, because we already know as believers this to be a matter of fact. But up until this point, no one had really revealed who Christ was. This was a great, deep revelation that even caught Jesus by surprise, I believe. I believe Jesus was like, I've gone through great efforts to disguise myself, to keep myself quiet, to keep myself undercover. Yet, you, Simon, has revealed who I am. He said, flesh and blood has not revealed this unto you, but my Father which is in heaven, meaning you have been given a direct deposit from heaven into your spirit, because this is not something that you could have got from the streets of Jerusalem. This is not something you could have got from the gossip amongst the town folks. This is not something you could have got from your other disciples. This came directly from my Father which in heaven. He said, since you have revealed who I am, watch this. Jesus says, I'm going to reveal who you are. He says, Simon, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. That is a powerful moment, and it brings me to the topic, and I'm coming to a close now, of what God gave me, his presence, my purpose. You see, it was when Peter revealed who Christ was that Christ revealed who Peter was. Jesus said, you're not just Simon. He says, you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church. Now this, I don't think we really understand the depth and the true significance of what is taking place here, because this, in the first time through Genesis to Revelation, this is the first time the word church is mentioned. That's a powerful thing, because here we see Jesus giving foresight and a glimpse to his plan for what he is going to leave behind post the cross, post the burial, and post his ascendance. He's saying, I'm going to build my church. I'm going to use you, Peter, to build my church. And true to his word, on the inauguration day of the church, which was the day of Pentecost, it was Peter who preached the message to 3,000 souls. That's a mega church right there. And he preached the message and he became the head apostle and the chief apostle among the other disciples. Peter found out who he was when he stepped into who God was. And I want to encourage every young person here under the sound of my voice, wherever you're listening from home, whether you're listening in your university, your dorm rooms, wherever you are, I want to encourage you to get into his presence. You've been trying to find your purpose and you've been going about it the wrong way. You're saying, I need to find out who I am before I start this, or I need to find out what it is I'm called to do before I... But God is saying, no. You find me and then it's in my presence you'll discover your purpose. Your purpose will become unfolded, and things about you that you didn't even know were there will become unfolded once you step into his presence. Things you didn't know you could do, you'll be able to do. Things about yourself that you didn't know were there will be revealed. Gifts that you didn't know you had, plans that you didn't know you had, songs that you never knew you had will all come to light once you step into his presence. In his presence there is fullness of joy, and at his right hand there are pleasures forevermore. And I guarantee you, without a shadow of a doubt, the moment you have a God encounter, throughout the Bible we read about encounters with God, when people came into encounters with God. You read about Jacob who wrestled with God, and when he stepped into the presence of God and had wrestled with him, God once again changed his name from Jacob to Israel. It's the same with Abraham, it's the same with Saul, who was on the Damascus Road, had an encounter with God, stepped into the presence of God, and God changed his name from Saul to Paul. So I want you to really use this moment. I know we're in a lockdown. I know things aren't progressing the way we would like it to do. We're a fast generation. We're always looking for what's happening next. But maybe we can utilize this moment. Discover God. Discover him in a new and living way. Discover him in a way that comes alive to you, whereby you have a living, breathing, vibrant relationship with him, whereby in every decision you make, you include him, understanding that it is in him you live, you move, and you will have your being. I promise you, your purpose is in his presence. He said, if you call on me, I will answer thee and show you great and marvelous things which ye know not of, because your eyes have not seen, your ears have not heard, neither has it even entered into the hearts of man that which I'm getting ready to do in and through you. Amongst my generation, I see giants. Amongst my generation, I see trailblazers. I see pastors, I see prophets, I see evangelists, I see apostles, I see teachers, I see CEOs, I see book writers, I see songwriters, and it is all going to be unlocked, that inner man, that predestined plan that God has for you, the things that he has designed for you to do will all be established and will manifest when you step into his presence. So right now, I pray that you will take this time and really examine yourself and say, God, I want to get to know you. I don't want to just have a form of godliness and never really encounter you for myself. Yes, I've been coming to church. Yes, I know your word. Yes, I know the song, but I want to know you. I want to know you for you. And when I find you, I believe and I know that I will find myself, for my hidden treasures are in him. God bless you. God keep you. And I pray that this word has encouraged somebody, anybody, even if this is one person, in Jesus' name. Amen.
God says that I am, I am. I am all that you need. At this moment in time, I'm going to call on Sister Darian, and she's going to do a spoken word for us in Jesus' name.
Let's bless the Lord, everyone. And another time. I've come with a poem today that I wrote a while ago, but it was during just speaking with God, and I was just being very honest and vulnerable with God, basically looking at myself, looking at the way that I live, and if I truly live the life that he needs me to live. And so I was just kind of questioning my actions and things like that, and this is just the word that he gave me. So I just pray that, it was very personal, however, I pray that someone also receives something from it today as well. We want heaven. We want to sit with him in glory. As we speak of a life holy, while our lives show a different story, how do we live in this world and show Christ on this earth? In the way that we live, or big hats and long skirts, why do we wait for a title for that qualification? When we were born into authority to evangelize to a nation, I see there may be some frustration when you feel you lack information, but God stays to be our teacher when we make time for that conversation, because God pours. And when you ask for understanding and wisdom, it's yours, because he pours into us so much that you'd never know, and he continues to go so much that there is this heavy overflow, but that's not for us to keep, but to share on to the next, not just to collect knowledge in our heads and step out to just flex. How did we last pour into man? Was it to give to get back? When did you last pour into them? Was it Jesus or Jack? Did you just know the fact that the glory goes back to our teacher and leads a friend to a life that creates a believer? He heard you speak of commitment, which every day you keep fighting, but who promised you tomorrow? Choose the Lord today without whining, because our timing on this earth is never known, nor is it rising. For it's in Christ we'll find ourselves, and in his arms we are invited. What do we live for? How much Christ do people see in me? Does it come from work or labels, or is it through my ministry? What do we live for? What have I prioritized first? Are you a shadow in darkness, or are you salt of the earth? Can we ever be satisfied in just him over anything else? And most importantly, how much Christ does Christ see that's in you of himself? Thank you.
Let us give God some praise one more time in the house. Come on, let us lift up his name. You have made a great effort just to be here today, despite all the situations that surrounds us. Hallelujah. And the glory is to God. Hallelujah. I'm rejoicing. Something has happened to me that I never thought I could have done. But the Lord brought me through marvelously. And here I am standing before the house of faith. Glory be to God, just lifting up the name of Jesus. He's amazing. Hallelujah. He's amazing. I mean, when I listen to Brother Pinnock, amazing. You know, sometimes we say, that was the message. That was the word. But the Lord of abundance to pour into us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I just want to thank God for the youth department. Again, you have just blessed my soul. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. With everything, the everything that God has done. Now listen to this, because you see, as we have recognized and we understand, I'm going to say this. Pharaoh wanted Moses to leave, leaving the children behind. He wanted him to go, take everything else but the children. Because what happens? The children grow up. They become adults. And all that would happen, they would have furnished Pharaoh with another generation of slaves. Hallelujah. Oh, my amazing God. Moses said, no, when we go together. We go with everything that we have. Bless the Lord, saints. Bless God again. Keep praying for our young people. Hallelujah. We're just seeing the unraveling of what's really deep down inside of them. Hallelujah. We've just seen, you know, tip of the iceberg. So keep them in your prayers. May God bless you today. And right now, I just want to introduce to you the preacher for the day. Minister Jazzy was burning with something in his spirit that he wanted to share with us. Praise the Lord. And so let us just rise to our feet and give God thanks for the man of God, Minister Jazbor, as he comes to us. Pray him up in your spirit in Jesus' name. Amen.
God bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. I thank God for allowing me and us to be here. I am truly, I'm intrigued and inspired because this morning it seems that we cannot leave the book of Exodus. I don't know about you, but I've just seen something quite magnetic seems to be keeping us in the book of Exodus. And I was equally as inspired when I heard Seth Pinnock again going to talk about the miracles that were contained in the book of Exodus. Contained in the book of Exodus, and how he was thirsting to want to see the supernatural. I don't know about you, but I can concede to this. I am also in a position and at a place I want to see God's mighty hand. In such a time as this, I really want to see God's manifestation. And what I can say, God never ceases to work. The problem is we may not be at the place to see it. And I also am blessed to be here on the Youth Sunday to see the young people. And especially at a time where this is the 31st of January 2021, the last Sunday and or the day of January. We move into February tomorrow. But so much has happened in the 31 days. Some people have gone and left this earth, and because of what, excuse me, is happening with the virus, and Some are being brutally killed. We had a young person that was killed in Handsworth. In order for you to feel that, you got to have children. And for me, my oldest daughter is 18 and I got children, and I look and I say to myself, Lord, we've got to pray. If any time now that we have to intercede for the world is now. I mean, singing is good and I was inspired by the songs, and preaching is good. But we really need now for God to step in. We need God to step in. But I thank God today to be here, to Pastor Lewis and his wife, to the saints, to the church, to people that are watching and viewing and listening. The interesting thing about God is that when people are expecting a messenger to give something, I'm also expecting God to give it to me. It's a double-edged sword. That's the power of how God works. And today, over the last few weeks, or the experiences that we've been having, have caused us now to want to seem to search even more. We heard it in the earlier exhortations online about seeking and finding God in a time as this. And presented before us this morning is a very interesting narrative, a very interesting book, and a very interesting story. In Exodus, as we go into what we can ask God to reveal to us, we find it is a very interesting account, primarily of one man's calling. We could argue that. And if I was to describe something from the experiences what Moses had, in starting from Exodus chapter 3, when Moses, the man of God, met with God face to face, I would say, or from what is written, for the very first time, I reckon he must have blew his mind. And if I was to put a topic or a subject from Exodus chapter 3, I would simply say, your or our mission impossible is God's opportunity to work. Moses was presented with a mission impossible. But as we read Exodus chapter 11, what also came to me, and we could have read a bit more, was it was also to do with God wanting to really demonstrate himself. That's what God wanted to do. And I just want to quickly connect or correlate 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 1 to 5, with what was read earlier, and also between the two Exodus and what Paul says. Listen to what Paul says. And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with what? Excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Here is the emphasis. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in trembling. Listen to this. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of what man's wisdom. We're hearing enough of that. But what in the demonstration of the Spirit. Listen to what it said. In the demonstration of the Spirit and of power. That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. Paul really puts the icing on the cake when, having been a rabbi himself, understanding all the accounts and the experiences and the manifestations of God in the Old Testament, was highly convinced and persuaded that somehow man has made God to be something that can be understood by books. There is a lot of literature, there is a lot of information around. And yes, you can get to know about God by reading. You can. You can get to know God or get to feel some sort of sensation in your body when you hear the songs of God. You can get some sort of inspiration when you listen to the messages of God. But taking all that into consideration, it appears that there is still something missing. The mission then, that has become so impossible. We are seeing it right now. And just for the record, this COVID and this pandemic, as it seems to have paralyzed a lot of us, even if we're not affected or a recipient of having COVID, but the very fear of catching it causes you to keep your distance. Is someone hearing me? The very fear of knowing there's a strong possibility that you can catch this virus would also or almost suggest that your faith is more caught up with the virus than with God. And listen, Moses, and we talk about history and we talk about plagues before I move on to this point. In Exodus, we know about the plagues that God said to Moses, I'm going to bring. And we got to take this into consideration at a time when people could still catch a disease, a sickness, or even an illness. It was still possible, and it did happen. But that did not stop God from working. That did not stop God from telling Moses that though I am about to bring these plagues into Egypt for a particular reason, I am still going to protect my people that are called by my name. God said that. And a disease is a particular abnormal condition that negatively affects the structure or function or part of an organism. That's what they define a disease as. A plague is a very severe disease. It can affect the bloodstream. It can be fatal unless treated. So let's take that point into consideration. If it is fatal and God is working his miracle or his hand against Pharaoh, which you could say represents a kind of a devil and a system, he's coming against something that was coming against the people of God. And God was very key and instrumental when he told Moses what to do. When Moses was on the mountain, he wasn't just simply to have a conversation with God. It was at the point that God turned up, or called Moses rather, that God imparted the supernatural to him. We heard it earlier and the brother spoke about it. I want to see the supernatural. When God and Moses spoke, Moses, prior to entering that environment or that particular place where God told him to come, was just another individual. But after meeting with God and talking with God, Moses was somehow transformed. God told Moses, now I want you to go tell Pharaoh and the Israelites and all the other individuals that I am going to do my mighty works in that particular land. Notice, he told him, and Moses must have scratched his head like you and me. He said, well, that's fine, but how am I ever going to convince, or how are they going to know that you sent me? It's not like you and me that we can carry a Bible and someone says, well, he's another Christian or he's another believer in God. God had to do something that was so unique with Moses that the people would have begun to say, now there's something different about you. If the church in the 21st century is acting like the world and listening to the media that's suggesting and dictating to us what to do, then my question to you and everybody listening, God already told us what to do. Yes, we are in a mission and we are in a crisis, but you've got to take into consideration that doesn't matter to God. That affects you and me. But what is happening in this mission impossible in this earth, it is really creating an opportunity for God to work. Amen. Are you relying upon a system? Are you relying upon a vaccine? Or are you relying upon what God can do? There is a big difference. Listen, even great men of old had said about the Bible and what God can do. Even scientists speak about this book and what God can do. So Isaac Newton said, physicist, and he was an astrologer and a theologian, said, we account the scriptures of God to be the most sublime philosophy. Even presidents in America and around the world and said, had turned around and said, it is impossible to rightly what divide the world without God, or govern the world without God and the Bible. If you are trying to get through this world without using what God told you, you are going to fail. It feels as though you may be succeeding, but listen, you are going to fail because you have not done it the way God said it. Look at this. God told Moses there in Exodus chapter 9, though I am going to go and kill the firstborn, but before I do that, there are two reasons why I need to work in Egypt. Before you leave Egypt, there are two significant reasons. And the first reason was, God told them that I need to get my glory. In Exodus 9, God said, I need to get my glory. That is one of the first reasons why I need to work in Egypt before you come out. The other reason was, God said that I am going to put what a distinction between Egypt and Israel. Look at these saints of God. God said, I need to put a difference between the church and the world. God said, I need to put a difference between a believer and an unbeliever. Listen, saints of God, God knows what he's doing. So when God told Moses to do it, God said, but before I come down, What I want you to do, Moses, is tell the Israelites in Egypt. And notice, saints of God, Egypt had a lot of things going on there. Plagues and sicknesses, and people were dying like today. People were getting killed. There was idolatry. There was paganism. Now, the Bible talks about we are in a spiritual Egypt. It talks about this is still is Egypt today, but the things that are going on are more spiritual. They are more sinister and working behind closed doors. So it doesn't change on that basis. So it is still Egypt in that regard. And God said now to Moses, what I want you to do, Moses, is tell the Israelites, take the blood that you kill and sacrifice and put it where? On the doorpost. Take the blood and put it, because when I tell you to do it, I've got to assign the death angel to go into Egypt and kill the firstborn. When God does something, there's a reason for it. God don't kill for joke, and God doesn't judge for joke. What is going on in the world today is people knew the power of the blood of Jesus. If people knew how powerful the blood of Jesus is and how to get it, that's what the blood in Egypt was signifying, that we need to be covered in blood. How do you and me get covered in blood? Now, in the Old Testament, they put the blood on the door on wood. That's where they put the blood. Now, Jesus said at the Lord's Supper, now, eat or drink, drink of my blood. This is my blood that is shed for many. You see, without the remission of the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. That's why people are dying today like flies. I believe, church, that if the world can grasp what we are talking about, that this mission impossible that Boris Johnson is talking around, and what Trump was talking about, and China and all the countries in the world are talking about, if they can grasp the principles of God and apply what God is saying, I personally believe people won't die like they're supposed to be dying. Saints of God, we have had plagues over the years, over the last hundreds and thousands of years, back from 430 BC, and we had the Black Death in 1350 AD, and 1665 we had the Great Plague. People were dying, and the Spanish flu in 1918, and about 50 million people worldwide were dying from these things. But I believe, like God told Moses, if you do what I say, nothing shall hurt you. If you do what I say, I will protect you. Some of the young people in the streets that are dying need God. The people that are dying in their beds need a supernatural work of God. The preaching can't save them, and the teaching can't save them. What we need, church, is a supernatural hand of God. We need God to go into the hospitals and God to go into the nursing homes and to somebody that believes God to take the hands that God has made and say, in the name of Jesus, rise. Come on, saints of God. You cannot be scared when the Holy Ghost is working. You cannot say, I can't touch you because it's contagious. Listen to me. When Jesus came here and the people had leprosy, Jesus never said, I can't touch you, I'll be contagious. Jesus said, you come here, come quickly. And when they came, Jesus said, be healed. And what happened, brothers and sisters, the person that had leprosy was healed. And Jesus just said, go and show yourself to the priest. Listen, saints of God, Jesus was demonstrating to the church the true power of God. That's what Moses was demonstrating. It is time in 2021 to demonstrate what God is talking about. I believe there are people right now in their beds. If they can get God to them, I believe God will heal you. There are people right now in different religions.
religions, in mosques or temples, in different cultures. I believe if you can take your hand and say, just let me pray for you, I believe they will be healed. Come on, saints of God. I believe they'll be healed from the virus and from the COVID. I know through the years, and it's written in the Bible and in the books here, that God healed many plagues. The Bible said when Jesus was here, Jesus healed all manner of what? Illness, sickness, and disease. There was nothing that Jesus did not heal when he was here. Now notice, God is still here. God is still working. So why is the diseases increasing? Why is the plagues increasing? It's not because God has stopped working. We have stopped believing. Listen, saints of God, this is an opportunity for the church to demonstrate what God is doing. This time, saints of God, is an opportunity. I believe in this church and in the broadcast, people are going to be healed. I believe this. 2021, saints of God, is a healing year. This is a year that God is going to heal. This is a year. God is telling us, church, this is the year that God is going to heal, and that people are going to walk in to this church and other churches and say, thank you for your prayers. This was truly a mission impossible, but God made it possible. Thank you, Jesus. This was truly impossible. The government and scientists said no, but God said yes. Saints of God, God wants to heal. Wants to heal somebody. To testify. To show to this world that the God that we serve, I don't know about any other religion, but the God that we serve, the apostolic church that we serve, can heal them. Come on, saints. God can heal them. I believe this. God can heal. Just pick up the phone and speak in Jesus' name. If somebody can't get to you, you can get to them. Pick up the phone this week and watch God work. Pick it up tonight and watch God work. God told Moses that I will stretch out my hand and show you my miracle. And when he stretched the rod, it parted the Red Sea. Saints, God through your hands is going to heal some people. Come on, saints of God. No doubting. No doubting. No fear. Regardless of what the TV and the media say, or even what some of the churches say. I don't believe what the church says. I believe what God says. And if God said it's possible, it is possible. Same with you, young people. You take your hands that God made and you lay them on people. And don't be scared. Because remember this, when the healing comes, they are the same ones that's going to thank God for you. Come on, saints. Don't let fear paralyze you. The Bible said, closing, God has not given us the spirit of fear that is of the world. It is imparted through the media. It is imparted in some of your conversations. But God said he never gave us that. But of a sound mind and of power. God gave us and gave us the Holy Ghost. He's going to do the work. You are just a vessel. Listen to me again. You are just a vessel that God is going to use. Come on, you are the vessel. Your hands God is going to use. And healing is going to come. God bless you this morning. God bless you this morning. Hallelujah to God. We are a healing and a miracle church. This is going to happen. God said in 2021, this
is going to happen. God bless you as Pastor Neil comes. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, come on, give God a praise today. Give God a praise. It's the healing year. Hallelujah to God. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. God bless you.
Thank you, Minister Jazz, for being obedient to the word of God and ministering to us. That's the God we serve. So again, I say to you, fear not. And this is the word of God. Fear not, neither be afraid, for the Lord our God is with us. Please stand and bow your heads in the name of Jesus. Eternal Father and our God, there is just none like you. And we know, Lord, there is none to be compared, nor is there any God but you. And so we thank you for this moment that we've been able to bask in your presence, receiving the encouragement by your word. Father, to know that even though it seems like we're on an impossible mission, it is the opportunity and time for God to work in the very midst of all things that we are facing. I thank you again, Lord. I thank you for your blessings. And may your blessings overflow upon the hearts of your people, everyone that believes. Father, and those who are watching on Zoom and have not yet understood the power of God. They didn't know it then, but now hearing the word, I pray, Father, that they will receive you in their lives. God, and give their lives to you. For if my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face, I will hear from heaven, saith the Lord, and I will heal your land. We are thankful, Father, that we've been able to come together in this fashion to worship your great name. And as we go from here, I pray you go with us with a blessing, I pray thee, upon us now, in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, all of you who are online listening. May God bless you. And for every one of you that is in the house of God, I thank you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. We just pronounce the benediction. And we say it this way. Let the words of our mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. God bless you, beloved ones. Hallelujah. Go in peace and may the blessings of God rest upon you. In Jesus' name.
We would like to take this opportunity to invite you to sow a seed in the ministry here at Bethel Lighthouse. The Bible tells us that our reward for giving comes from God, and we welcome your gift to support our many ministries. You can give by following the details on the screen or by clicking the giving link in the description box. God bless you.